Phantom Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars, Showdown at Centerpoint, Volume 3 of the Corellian Trilogy by Roger MacBride Allen.
Solo, we are running out of time. We will be entering atmosphere soonest if our approach is not controlled.
Either the comm circuit up to the ship's control cabin was on the verge of giving out again, or else Han had just gotten lucky and Drachmas was about to lose her voice. Han slapped the answer switch and tried to stay focused on his work. Keep your shirt on, Drachmas. Tell honored pilot Selkul that I'm nearly done.
What shirt? Should shirts be worn? Is this for safety?
Han sighed and pushed the answer button again. It's an expression. It means be patient. Drachmas was a Selonian, and most Selonians did not like being in space. Understandable for a species that mostly lived underground, but having an agoraphobic who wasn't even a pilot in command of a rundown cone ship was enough to drive anyone crazy. Han Solo engaged the power switch, waited for the inverter system to energize, and crossed his fingers. He was starting to question his sanity in volunteering to help fly this particular cone ship down out of free space to the surface of Selonia. He could have said, so long and good luck, and ridden down with Leia on the Jade's Fire. But when a job needed doing and no one else could do it, volunteering was not really all that voluntary. He had obligations to Drachmas and to her people. And Drachmas had made it clear that her people, the Selonians, or more accurately, the Hunchuzuk Den, couldn't afford to abandon any spacecraft, no matter what shape it was in. Knowing he was with the Hunchuzuk would have been a bit more useful if Han had had some clear idea about who or what the Hunchuzuk Den was. All he knew for sure was that the Den was part of an amorphous faction of Selonians who had left their planet in the Corellian system to live on his own home planet of Corellia. And that so far as Drachmas knew, they were still allied to a pro-New Republic alliance of Selonian dens called the Republicists. Drachmas had either kidnapped Han or rescued him from Thrakken Sal Solo, Han's cousin and the leader of the thugs who called themselves the Human League. Or both, Han was still not sure. The Hunchuzuk seemed to be having a fight with the Overden, the leadership on Selonia proper, a fight that was going on in parallel with the New Republic's battle against the rebellions in the Corellian system, though the two did not seem to be directly related to each other. The Overden wanted absolute independence for Selonia. Han was coming to the conclusion that each side was primarily against the other, but Drachmas had saved his life and she had taken risks to treat him well. Han knew that Thrakken Sal Solo had treated Drachmas' people with the utmost cruelty. Since relatives in Selonian society were genetically identical, Selonians were likely to assume that Han was a villain like his cousin, yet Drachmas had given him every benefit of the doubt.
When will it be working? The planet is getting closer.
Don't hold me to this, but I think the spare parts off Mara's ship did the trick. We ought to be able to get underway anytime you like. The indicators flickered to show the inverters were drawing more power. Take it easy up there. Throttle up nice and slow, all right?
We are doing so, Arnold Solo. We have no desire to overload our systems again.
Han climbed up to the nose cabin of the cone ship. The cone ship was just that, a fat cone with the engines at the base and the control cabin in the point. The nose itself was nearly all transplex, affording a spectacular overhead view. The Selonia pilot, Selkul, lay flat on her back, looking up and out at the sky ahead. She gave Han a toothy smile and returned her attention to her work, but the large, otter-like creature looked anything but calm. How does all go? Han asked Selkul, speaking in his rather labored Selonian. Selkul did not speak basic.
All is well, Arnold Solo. At least until the next subsystem flips out.
Wonderful, Han muttered. Salcold was a fairly experienced pilot and knew her ship reasonably well, if not as well as Han would have preferred. Drachmas, on the other hand, was trained to deal with humans. When it came to ship handling, she had no experience and no skill. Even so, she commanded the ship. Not just in deciding where it would go, but down to the detail of every maneuver. Salcool could not or would not overrule her. Drachmas was of higher status, and that was that. Neither seemed much concerned by the fact that Drachmas had only a slight understanding of space operations, or that during the battle between the New Republic and their allies against units from the various rebellions, she had repeatedly ordered the ship to do things it could not do, and had come alarmingly close to getting them all killed. The view out the transparent nose of the cone ship was nothing less than spectacular. The Selonian landmass was broken up into thousands of medium-sized islands, more or less evenly spaced across the face of the planet. But there was more to the view than the planet. Mara Jade's personal ship, the Jade's Fire, hung in space a kilometer or two away, her bow hiding a bit of the planet's equatorial region. Mara's ship was long and streamlined, painted in a flame pattern of red and gold. The ship looked fast, sleek, strong, maneuverable, and Han knew she was all of those things. After Drachmas had given Salcool orders that had blown out nearly every system on board the cone ship, the fire had rescued them and provided Han with the spare parts he needed to repair the craft. Now the fire was preparing to see the cone ship to a safe landing. A bright light flashed on and off from the forward port of the fire. Leia was using the landing lights on the Jade's Fire to send Mon Calamari blink code, combinations of long and short flashes to form the letters of the basic alphabet. Ready to begin entry, Han read. Signal when ready. Ana Drachmas, take your seat and prepare for acceleration. Salcool, you will fly a standard approach to the intended field of landing, starting on my command. Is that understood?
Yes, indeed, absolutely.
As Han watched, the Jade's Fire came about on her long axis, putting her stern toward the cone ship. Salcool edged the throttle upward, transferring minimum power to the engines. As the cone ship began to accelerate toward the planet, the fire drifted back. As the more maneuverable ship, it made sense for the fire to go in second, where she could keep watch on the cone ship. But the cone ship was all but completely blind astern. All she had was one wide-angle camera set in the base of the cone between two of the sublight engines. It would be useful during the final approach and landing, but even with the main engines off, its resolution was so poor that the Jade's Fire would be lost to view if she drifted only a few kilometers away. The poor visibility made for another good reason to have the fire go in second. Better to have a ship you trusted at your back. At least a ship you more or less trusted. Han had managed to put to rest most of his reservations regarding Mara. He could think of no reason, no motive for her acting against Han and Leia and the Republic, despite her past as the Emperor's hand. But in recent days, she had been in the right places at the right times, and the wrong places at the wrong times. A bit too often. On the other hand, if she had wanted to do real damage, Mara was too much of a pro to let things be bungled. Say whatever else you might about the woman, Mara was competent. The planet moved closer. In another few minutes, Salcool would have to turn the ship over and point its engines forward to slow the craft. That was the part that worried Han. Once they were decelerating, they would be at their most vulnerable. The cone ship's fragility was far from the only source of danger. Someone on Selonia had sent a whole fleet of light attack fighters up to attack the Bakuran ships that were assisting the New Republic on this mission. The Bakurans had done a fair amount of damage to the LAFs, but Han had to assume that whoever commanded them would have the sense to hold some in reserve. To make matters worse, the cone ship was completely unarmed and had no shields at all. Leia Organa Solo, Chief of State of the New Republic, sat at the navigator's station aboard the Jade's Fire, watching the cone ship drift in toward Selonia. What exactly was Han getting them into? Leia was forced to think not just like a wife, but like a politician. There was no question that Han was being drawn in by these Selonians, and that she was being drawn in as well. It would be all too easy for the New Republic to find itself involved in one side or the other of the fight.
He'll be all right, Leia, Mara said. We'll stay right with them all the way down.
Hmm? What? Oh, yes, Leia said. It was mortifying to be reassured by Mara Jade, of all people. Mara frowned and adjusted the thrust controls.
That Selonian pilot needs a flying lesson or two. She's doing the pitchover maneuver way too early, and without shutting off her engines, nearly clipped her. Mara was forced to fly evasive patterns just to keep the fire from crashing into the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.